Well, good morning, everybody. It is great to have you with us this morning. So let me be the first to say to you, Happy Sunday!
Happy Sunday!
Well, how many of you feel excited to be in church this morning? Let me see a show of hands. You're excited to be here. Every hand is up in this place, and that feels great because I tell you what, I can feel your energy and I can feel your enthusiasm. So thanks so much for coming out and making this a great morning for everybody around you. You know, somebody told me years ago, someone said to me, sometimes the most loving thing that you can do for a person is look them in the eye and tell them the truth. And today, God is going to look you in the eye and tell you the truth through the words of Jesus. So if you've got a seatbelt this morning, you might want to get strapped in right now because we're ready to take off. We're looking at a chapter of the Bible called Luke chapter 18. You can just follow along on the screen today or on your outline. It's a story of two guys. Two guys who go to church one day. And Jesus is the one who told the story. The Bible says this. Then Jesus told this story to some who had great self-confidence and scorned everyone else. Jesus said, two men went to the temple to pray. One was a Pharisee, and the other was a dishonest tax collector. The proud Pharisee stood by himself and prayed this prayer. I thank you, God, that I am not a sinner like everyone else, especially like that tax collector over there, for I never cheat. I don't sin. I don't commit adultery. I fast twice a week, and I give you a tenth of my income. But the tax collector stood at a distance and dared not even lift his eyes to heaven as he prayed. Instead, he beat his chest in sorrow, saying, Oh God, be merciful to me, for I am a sinner. Jesus said, I tell you, this sinner, not the Pharisee, returned home made right with God. For the proud will be humbled, but the humble will be honored. In other words, if you're the type of person who walks through life with your nose up in the air all the time, you're going to fall flat on your face. So that's the story Jesus told. So let's take a look at it. Put on the brakes. Let's not move through it too quickly. Think about that story a little bit. First of all, you've got two guys featured in that story. Two men, right? So let's look at them. Exhibit A, I present to you a Pharisee. Let's call him Phil. Pharisee Phil. Phil the Pharisee. Now, Phil's a good guy. Phil's a really good guy. He really is. He's respected. He's religious. He's a law and order type guy. Phil says, thank God I'm not like all the rest of them. You know, losers. He thinks he's pretty good. And in fact, he is pretty good. By the time he was 12 years old, get this, by the time he was 12 years old, Phil had memorized the first five books of the Bible. Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy. He memorized it. Not just the names of the books of the Bible. I mean, he memorized the entire books, word for word. If you want to be a Pharisee, you've got to have it all committed to memory, and they're going to quiz you on it when you're 12 years old. On top of that, there are 613 laws in the Old Testament. Now, our boy Phil not only read those laws, he memorized them, and he lived them to a T. Now, I tell you, I'm pretty proud of myself this morning because I remembered the number 613. But he lived them. He lived them to a T. And you could say that Phil's motto in life is, I don't smoke or drink or chew, and I don't go with girls who do. He's a good guy. Then, on the other hand, Exhibit B, I present to you the tax collector. Let's call him Tony. Yo, Tony. Tony the tax guy. I mean, forget about it. He's a crook. He's mobbed up. He talks with a Jersey accent, right? Yo, Tony, what's up? I'll tell you what's up about Tony. He's a dirty, rotten traitor. He makes his money collecting for the enemy. He's kind of the bag man for the Roman Empire, the empire that's occupying his homeland and who's oppressing his people. And he's basically, you know, he's basically allowed to collect as much money as he wants, and as long as Rome gets their cut, he can keep his cut. So he's kind of, you know, doing what we call dipping the beak, you know what I'm saying? So Tony the tax guy is enormously wealthy, but he's also enormously hated. So now, when Jesus told this story back in the day, you got to understand that everybody in the audience that day could picture exactly what he's talking about. They would know a Phil and a Tony from their own hometown. They would have a picture in their mind. And when Jesus stopped and he said to them, "So who do you think was right with God? Who do you think pleased God the most? Which one, Phil or Tony?" Well, you can guess that every single person in that audience that day said, "Well, obviously. I mean, come on, obviously. Phil, the Pharisee's the good guy." Well, Jesus would let a pause hang in the air, and then he would look him in the eye and he'd say, "Let me tell you, God was more moved by Tony the tax collector than he was from Phil the Pharisee." Jesus let his words kind of just settle in the air. And then he looked him in the eye and he told them the truth. "I tell you, this sinner, not the Pharisee, returned home made right with God." And they probably said that day, and we're probably saying today, "Well, how can that be? How in the world could that be?" Well, I'll tell you why. Because Phil the Pharisee was all about Phil the Pharisee, right? Phil was full. Phil was full of himself. And here's the thing. When we are full of ourselves, there's no room for God, right? Think about it. When we're all about ourselves and we're full of ourselves, there's no room for God to get in there and do anything. How do I know that Phil is full of himself? I know because I see Phil playing the comparison game. He's like, "Thank God I'm not like them," right? Especially not like that dirty, rotten tax collector. Comparison. Why do we compare? Because it's easier to feel value in ourselves when we compare our good qualities to someone else's bad qualities, right? We say, "Well, I'm pretty good in comparison to them, after all," and then we compare our strengths to their weaknesses. And what are we doing? We lift ourselves up by pushing others down. Phil's not the only one who does it. We see it all the time, right? Like maybe you hear one of your friends say, "Hey, look what that woman is wearing. I mean, does she think she looks good in that outfit? I mean, somebody should have told her before she walked out the door today, girlfriend, you do not look good like that," right? Or maybe for you, maybe it's that you're an expert at fault finding. You know people like this, right? Just an expert at fault finding. And I'll tell you what, you like to look at other people's faults and concentrate on their faults, because then you don't have any time left over to look at your own faults and work on that stuff. Or maybe for you, I don't know, maybe for you it's not fault-finding, it's attention-seeking. Maybe it's like, "Everybody look at me, it's all about me over here. Did you see how many likes I got on Facebook this week? You see my Instagram? I mean, I'm like killing it on Instagram." And you know, I'll tell you, you know who the worst category is when you talk about comparison? Parents. I'll tell you, it goes something like this. "Well, like, babe, I mean, I know we're not the best parents, but I mean, compared to Brad and Michelle's kids, I mean, Brad and Michelle's kids are like out of control. We might as well just put them into prison right now, because that's where they're headed," right? See, we lift ourselves up by putting others down. And you know what happens next? You know the weird thing? Instead of seeing all the good things in our life as a gift from God, we begin to see ourselves as the gift to God. You know, instead of having the attitude when we walk in here like, "God, thank you so much for this amazing church. I mean, God, you brought me to a church where hearts are touched and people are moved every single week." Instead, our attitude is, "Well, God, I'm here today. You're welcome." Or, you know, instead of, "God, thank you so much for my amazing family. You've given me two beautiful, beautiful kids." Instead, it's like, "God, I brought my kids to church today. You're welcome." Or instead of thank you for my job, thank you for a paycheck that comes in every week. It's like, here I am, God, I brought my offering envelope. You're welcome. You see what I'm saying, right? You're getting what I'm talking about. Instead of seeing all the good things in our life as a gift from God, we begin to see ourselves as the gift to God. Our attitude is kind of like, I'm a child of God and I'm doing all the right stuff, so you're welcome. So back to the story. Tony, the tax guy. Tony knows he's a mess. Tony knows he doesn't have a leg to stand on. Tony walks into the temple. He slumps in the shadows, his face in his hands, not even daring to look up. And he just kind of says, oh God, oh God, oh God, have mercy on me. Have mercy on me and forgive me because I'm a sinner. He knows, Tony knows there's no possible way he deserves to be included in the kingdom of God. Tony knows there's no way that when he dies, he's not going to be welcomed into the kingdom of heaven. He's not going to heaven when he dies. He knows he's a mess and he doesn't have a leg to stand on. But here's what he discovers. When we empty ourselves, we're in a perfect position to be filled by God's grace. When we finally empty ourselves, that just places us in the perfect position for God to really get in there and do something. And some of you have discovered this. You've learned this in your life. It wasn't until your life humbled you, until a certain situation in your life kind of emptied you of all that pride, that God really could get into your life and do some work inside of you. Kind of think, you can think about it this way. Think of this. A few years ago, I got this very bright idea. This is some years ago. I decided I was going to join the Southwick Adult Men's Basketball League. I think, I can play. I mean, I got game. You know what I'm saying? Like, I used to play basketball every single day in high school and in college. Back in college, I could dunk the ball. I mean, I could dunk it with one hand. I'd get up there and dunk it with two hands. I could do it with my eyes well, maybe not my eyes closed, but I could jam that ball. And so, I mean, I still run and work out every day, and I'm thinking, you know what? I'm going to do just fine out there. So I show up game one. I show up, they hand me the shirt. Here it is, so you know I'm not making it up. Here's the famous jersey from back in the glory days. Jumpin' Jeffrey King, number 3, number 1 in your hearts. So as I'm getting my jersey on, I'm looking around, and I'm starting to notice something kind of funny. All the other guys there were like in their very young 20s. And I'm thinking, well, you know, I'm old, but I'm in great shape. Coach says, King, you're going to play forward. I'm like, no problem. Coach, I got this. I mean, get ready to start writing down number 3 in the scorebook, because I'm going to be scoring a lot this game. I mean, a lot. Well, ladies and gentlemen, the game begins. We're playing full court. I'm sprinting up and down, back and forth, up and down the court. And I'm here to tell you today, no lie, no exaggeration, in less than a minute, I'm clutching my chest and I'm gasping for breath. I am panting and sweating and wheezing out there. And these young guys, they are racing past me. They're flying by like I'm standing still. That's 1 minute. 2 minutes in, my legs are like rubber, and my heart is throbbing, and my heart in my chest cavity is like a wounded bird flopping around in there. 3 minutes in, I'm starting to silently pray that the coach will take me out of the game. Please take me out. Take me out before I pass out was my motto. I figure better to sit on the desk, on the bench, than lie on a stretcher. 4 minutes in, I'm texting Kathy saying, check my life insurance policy. You know, hashtag only the good die young. Now listen, the point of this whole thing is this. I wonder how many of us think we're really better than we are. Because I'll tell you, going into that, I thought I was a lot stronger than I really was. I thought I was a lot better. In fact, I could say, I think I'm really pretty good compared to most people. And I wonder, when I look out there this morning, I wonder how many of us think, Well, I'm really pretty strong morally, spiritually. I think I'm really doing pretty good. I think I'm really better than most people. I mean, after all, I go to church and I bought a study Bible. I know how to spell the word tithe, you know? Well, folks, listen to this. God's standard of goodness is way, way, way bigger than all that. You say, well, how big, Jeff? How big is God's standard of goodness? Well, Jesus answered the question. Jesus looked people in the eye and he told them the truth. He said, be perfect. You must be perfect, said Jesus. Perfect, just as perfect as my Father is in heaven. You say, but Jeff, that's impossible. Nobody could be perfect. That's the point. You could never, ever be perfect enough to deserve a place in the kingdom of God. You could never, ever, ever do enough good deeds and be good enough on your own to earn your place in heaven. In fact, let me ask you this. How many lifetimes would you have to live? How many good deeds would you have to do? If God gave you 1,000,000 lifetimes and said, do all the good you can, stack up all those good deeds, how much is enough? How many good deeds do you have to do so you can say, all right, I made it now. Now I totally deserve an eternity, an endless eternity in a perfect paradise, rubbing shoulders with Almighty God. There is only one way to be right with God, and that way is Jesus. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. Jesus says, I'm going to look you in the eye and I'm going to tell you the truth. Friend, you're not what you should be, but you can come to me. Come to me and you bring all those failures and bring those weaknesses and bring those mistakes and bring those sins to me and I will wash them away completely. I will wash you from the inside and make you as clean as can be. And then I will fill you with my goodness and my grace and my love. In fact, picture it this way. Picture a glass of water, and let's say that glass of water represents you. It represents your life. And imagine if that water that's in that glass represents what's inside of you, your eternal soul. Well, suppose we could see that water and we'd say, you know, that water's gotten kind of stale through the years, kind of cloudy, kind of dirty. And maybe it's not as dirty as some other people, but still you wouldn't want to drink it. Certainly not pure. Well, understand this. When you come to Jesus, he empties out all that dirty old water and he washes you clean, absolutely clean on the inside. That's what we mean when we talk about Jesus washes away sins. But he does more than just that. Here's what most people don't know. He not only gets rid of all the bad stuff, but once he's emptied you, he refills you with his own goodness, with his own grace. It's like refilling that glass with absolutely pure water. What am I saying? When we're full of ourselves, there's no room for God. But when we empty ourselves, we are then in a perfect position to be filled by God's grace. And one more thing. When we empty ourselves, we're in a perfect position to be used by God, to be mightily used by God. We discovered this. We discovered this together as a church. You know, first, we had a pretty good run, didn't we? First 10, 15 years, I'll tell you, we grew from one little service over in that building to five services a week. We became the first church in New England to have a live band and to use high-tech innovations to try to present the gospel. We grew to become the largest Lutheran church in New England. In the year 2000, we built this building. In the year 2008, we built another building in Springfield, and we opened up the Daily Grind Coffee House, and we were on a roll, and then, the bottom fell out. When the Great Recession hit, we couldn't pay our mortgage anymore. We couldn't pay our staff. We were facing foreclosure. We were literally in a position to lose it all. And I got to tell you, very honestly and humbly, I was like Tony the tax guy. I mean, I was on my knees just kind of crying out to God, saying, God, I'm empty. I'm helpless. God, have mercy on me because I'm at the end of my rope right now. And you know what? When we are empty like that, that's the moment we're in a perfect position to be filled by God and used by God. In a way that no one could foresee, God said to us, I got this. God brought us a Christmas miracle out of the blue, a million-dollar gift. It was God's way of saying, now you're in a perfect position to be used by me to really touch people. God said, look, it's always been about me. It's always been me. My hand of blessing has been upon this ministry in a very powerful and a very special way. It's not that you guys are exceptionally smart or clever or talented or holy or whatever. You naturally make a mess of things. But I supernaturally get in there and work to save you. And it was that supernatural outpouring that kind of just took us and raised us to the next level. And suddenly, I mean, I'm not kidding here, literally we were making headlines around the world. They were on Good Morning America talking about this little church in Southwick that had a Christmas miracle. We were being talked about on ABC, NBC, CBS, Fox News. People from all over were deeply moved by our story. They were impacted. They were growing in their faith. People around the country were telling me, I committed my life to Christ because of your church's story, because of your church's book, Fall Guy. And it was like mind-blowing. And what did we learn? When we empty ourselves, we're in a perfect position to be used by God. Yes, when we're full of ourselves, there's no room for God. When we empty ourselves, we're filled up with God. When we're filled up with God, we're in a position to be used by God. And so let's wrap up today by just praying that God now will fill you and use you mightily. Let's close our eyes and pray together. And would you permit me to guide you in this prayer? Let me start by asking you a question. How is your soul? Are things right between you and God? Maybe, to be honest, you've been a little bit full of yourself. You've been comparing your good qualities to other people's bad qualities. And you're like, you know, I think I'm doing pretty good. At least I got my act together compared to them. But truth be told, if we could look inside you, if we could look inside you like God does and see your soul, you'd kind of look like a dirty glass of water, stale, tinged, a little off. And so we pray an honest prayer this morning. We look God in the eye and we tell him the truth about ourselves. We pray, God, I'm sorry. I'm sorry. I ask your son Jesus to come into my life and drain away all the impurities and wash away all the sins. And then, when I'm completely empty, I ask him to pour his goodness into me. God, I'm not perfect, but I'm in a perfect position right now. The perfect position to be filled by your grace. And when I'm filled up with you, God, I'm in a perfect position to be used by you. So use me, God, for your glory. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. And now we pray together the words that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen.